The American Beauty Tim uses was made by Robust Tools. All our lathes have a 7-year warranty. Our tool rests feature a hardened rod on top. Lots of sizes to fit your lathe. Robust, because the making matters.
Thompson Lathe Tools. Welcome to a new level of professional wood turning tools. Made by a wood turner for wood turners. Today on Wood Turning, we're gonna make this really cool lighthouse. And I've got the lights down in the shop right now so you can see the effect that it gets when we put the light on the inside of the lighthouse. And that is actually an old electric insulator that you saw on those telephone poles if you're my age or older. Anyway, it lights up really cool. We thought that'd be a neat way to use something kind of antique-y. So I'm gonna turn the lights on in the shop right now so it's gonna get a little bit brighter. This is a really cool project. We're gonna be using Padauk for the orange parts, and we're gonna be using some darn if I know wood. Some stuff that I have had in storage for a very, very long time, and it came out beautifully. It's got spalting and everything. And if you look all the way down here in front of the bench, here's the piece we're gonna work with today. I think this is spalted hackberry. I'm not too sure. But this is a cool way to make a big project with little investment in the wood, because if you had to buy a piece of wood this big, it would cost you easily $100 or more, and it probably wouldn't be dried out either, so this would be a long project that you have to make. But anyway, it's a very simple system to put together. We have our insulator right here, which is so cool, and you can actually get these in all sorts of different sizes, so you don't have to make such a large lighthouse. But we decided to go big or go home, and I don't want to go home right now. And then up here, we have our first piece of Padauk, and you can see I've used copper to make these little arms here for the railing, and this is just some chain I picked up over at Michael's, a hobby store near me, to make the railing that goes around it. It's a really neat touch. Now let's see if I can get this thing out, because I went through a very long process trying to figure out how to light this sucker inside and came up with these. And these are little puck lights. I found them at Sam's Club. They sell them 5 or 6 to a pack for about $40. And that might seem extreme, but it's really cool because what I did, I went over to another hobby store, found these little LEDs, and I'm trying to figure out how do I put those in. They run off a CR23 battery or whatever. Same thing for these. These are used in weddings. They're really cool, but they don't put out a lot of light. And then there's also this type, which has, you can't see behind here, but this, the entire thing is a battery pack right there. So it's really hard to hide the battery pack. Even thought about going with these, which are little flicker candles. We've used those on Thanksgiving, or not Thanksgiving, on Halloween and our pumpkins and stuff. And they work pretty cool for that, but man, they don't put out a lot of light. And when I found these babies, I was so impressed. It's really cool. And I've got, hang on a second, it's right here. It even comes with a remote. So the cool thing is you can turn it on with the remote. The other cool thing is you can change the color. And it is really neat. It's hard to tell in the lighting we have right now. But when you change this color, look how that changes the glass. So you can get any mood, any effect you want. I think that's pretty cool. And then you go really bright with white. Also has a timer on it. Anyway, just look at Sam's Club if you want to buy that thing. And, oh yeah, office right here. you can get these pucks. But anyway, here's the fun part. We're going to be turning this big piece of wood on the lathe. And so the first thing we're going to do is start roughing out our rough blank that we have right down here. And this thing we're going to put between centers. And it's going to take a little while, but it's going to be a fun process. Now let's talk briefly about the big wood. And it is really cool when you can go out and harvest your own wood and then dry it to use it for projects later. It's very inexpensive. It is a lot of work though. People think it's easy, but it's not. But there's some things you gotta remember to do when you do this. If I go out here and I cut this blank of wood, I'm cut a tree down. First thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna cut out a round piece of the log. And one important thing is this one wasn't quite perfect, but you wanna make this a little bit longer than it is wide, because you're gonna get what you can see up here is cracking. Now, believe it or not, this was sealed. There is wood sealer. You paint it on, it's almost like a wax emulsion, or looks like Elmer's glue. And it keeps air and moisture from fighting each other, because what happens if you leave this open, moisture comes pouring out of this, because this is like a bunch of straw sitting up like that. And so all the moisture comes out. If you don't block it off, you get really big cracks. Now, this has been in my shed for 10 years, maybe, I think. I can't even remember. And so no matter what, it's gonna probably crack unless you keep up with putting the more sealer on it every 6 months to a year or whatever. I didn't keep up with that because I just didn't really care. I was trying to get it out of the way. My wife was on it, let's get rid of the extra wood kick, and so I hid this real quickly. Anyway, so it does have cracks, and I don't mind the cracks in this project because it's got a nice rustic look and it's gonna play off for pretty good. Now over on this piece, you're gonna notice I still have the bark on here, and we're gonna wanna take that off because the bark has a lot of dirt in it. You can even see dirt in here right there. Dirt and things like that will dull your tools quickly. Also, if anything is gonna fly off, it's gonna be the bark. I also have something I'll keep an eye on while I'm turning, is I have a check right here, a little crack. Probably I'll turn that away, and this will probably be the top of the lighthouse, so I'll go in deeper. But I'll definitely make sure I wear a face mask the entire time I'm roughing this out in case something comes loose. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I just wanna start getting rid of some of this bark. And sometimes I found out, if you're really lucky, you just whack it with a hammer and it comes off. If you're lucky. It starts loosening it. Or you can take a chisel and do it like this. And let's see which one has better results. Yeah, that works a little faster. Okay, so I'm gonna whack and chisel this for a little bit, get this cleaned off, and then we're gonna mount it on the lathe. Okay, with all the bark knocked off, you can see this is not a perfectly round blank because I had to cut it up with a chainsaw. This was so hard, I couldn't put it on my bandsaw. So I'm taking my compass, and I kind of got it close to the edge here. I'm taking it over here, I'm close to the edge there. I'm a little ways from the edge there, but I'm a ways from the edge here. I'm just trying to find like a center point that'll work. So I'm gonna mark this with an awl real quick. So I have my center point there. I'm gonna use that as a reference when I mount this. Let's see, this is gonna be the top of my thing, top of my lighthouse. So I want my tenon on this end. So this is gonna go into the headstock. So I'm gonna use a two-prong drive center in this, because if I use a four-prong, it's a little harder. Let me get one out. Think about this. If you're using four prongs, which one's gonna go in deeper, right? Okay, the four-prong is only gonna go in so deep. Look how deep and good grip you can get with the two-prong. That's why I like two-prong when I'm using wood like this, especially on green wood. This is not green, but this is nice hard wood, but I do wanna get good grip in here. So anyway, I wanna use a mallet and really drive it home, because I'm more worried about keeping a good grip on this than I am having a hole in the top of the wood. I can take care of that, that's no problem. So get this stuff out of the way. So now what we're gonna do is pick this up. We're gonna slide it in the headstock, and once it's in the headstock, I'm coming back over to the tailstock, and we're gonna slide it in right here. And we're gonna see where we are basically on. Ooh, that's spinning really nicely. I had already done a mark on here, so I knew where to put the point. So the point's in that hole. That looks good. But again, you can see this is one outer round piece of wood. The more work you can do with your chainsaw before you get to this point, the better off you are, because you're gonna have to start really slow and really carefully. Because, come over here, I'll show you. You've got, look at all this, see? Gap, wood, gap. See the difference right here on how there's so much room? So I wanna make sure that I find the widest point and set my tool rest up for that, and be somewhat close, but not terribly close. See, it's hitting right there, so we're gonna back that off a little bit. Okay, there we go. Okie doke. So since this is a tree, the grain's running this way, I can use my roughing gouge to rough this out, and that's what I'm gonna prep up for. Well, now I am geared up, and geared up means have a face shield on, especially with something like this, you gotta protect yourself. I wouldn't advise wearing gloves. People wanna do that because the chips hurt their hands, but if your glove catches that piece of wood, you get pulled into it. So go with bare hands. You can see I had a little incident with a piece of wood hitting me already. Nothing big, but I just didn't want it to be ugly and on camera. But it happens. So here's the important thing. We're gonna turn, boy, this one has a real echo. I love this new face shield, by the way, because it's a complete surround sound. It's a complete surround mask, and I love it. But anyway, I love this lathe because here's what I set the speed to. That ain't doing nothing, right? So I can slowly increase the speed until the lathe starts to wobble, because this is out of balance. It's gonna shake even this 800 and something pound lathe. The Robust is about as sturdy as they come, and this piece of wood, this little 15 pound piece of wood, will shake this lathe. Now you can see there's some movement, right? I wanna come back down again until the movement's gone. Now what I do is I come up with my roughing gouge, and I'm gonna ever so gently just start working my way in. Nothing there. Push it in a little more. There we go. And this is just a tedious, time-consuming process in this case, because we're gonna have to make this lumpy piece of wood round. So it'll probably take me about 10 minutes to do this. One important thing when I'm doing this turning, if Brian can see the silhouette up here on the edge of the wood, let's see, come over this way a little bit. There you go. Watch the silhouette of the wood and you'll see where I'm cutting. You can see the cut. That's where I watch with my eyes and see how much wood I'm taking off with each pass. By doing that, I know that I'm only taking about 1/8 of an inch and I'm not getting into trouble. So come back, do it again. So I'm just gonna repeat this over and over until we have a nearly rounded out cylinder. Things are getting a little bit rounder. And gotta tell you, I love the torque that's on this Robust lathe. It's not RPMs that's important, it's the strength of the motor, and the torque on here keeps this thing turning beautifully. We're at kind of a decision point here, because when you're turning a rough piece of wood like this, you might not be centered exactly right. So I'm gonna take this off, and we're gonna look at our center points again and see how things are working out. So, there's our center point there, and I have my calipers here somewhere. There they are. So we'll take these and put this in here. So I'm gonna take this and move this out to the very edge now. So we're going good. We're following the edge right. Okay, we're flat spotting there, right? So we're coming back here, coming back around here really good. All I'm gonna lose here, you can see the gap. If I don't change my center point, I'm only gonna lose 1/8 of an inch of diameter, which is not bad, that's really good. But let's look at the other end now and see how we're doing over there. Because I was wanting this end to be the bottom, to be the base, but as you can see, okay, I'm right on edge there, got a gap there, I'm on edge here. Ooh, got big gaps here. So look at this, that much gap, and then I'm over to the edge here. So that's telling me, that's what, 1/4 inch? I need to move this about 1/8 of an inch this way, so it's hanging over there. Now it should hang over here about the same amount. And then when I look up here, okay, I'm not to the edge there, and I'm hanging over the edge here, so I've got to bring this back just a little bit. I'm on the edge, I'm on the edge. Okay, back to that. Now I'm touching there, I'm not touching there. So this is what I mean, it's kind of fish it back and forth, figure out exactly where you need to be to use up as little wood as possible when you're rounding this out. So sometimes it's a compromise. Sometimes you're just gonna have to lose some wood to get it done. So what this is making me think right now is this is, instead of being the bottom, is gonna be the top of the lighthouse, because I'm gonna lose more up here when I make this round than I am down here. So anyway, I'm gonna fudge with this a little bit, get it mounted back on the lathe, and then we're gonna get it rounded out to a cylinder and start working on some other things. Welcome back to my grinding system that you hardly ever see. I'm just putting a fresh edge on the roughing gouge, because with this type of wood, it really dulls the tool quickly. Even though this is a really strong tool, you're still gonna have to sharpen. You have to sharpen all your tools usually. I had promised you a long time ago that I was gonna give you an update on my grinding system. I remember I'd gone to an 80 grit wheel, and it was a blue wheel, and it was more friable and all that. Well, I decided to advance myself from there. These are called CBN wheels, and I don't know exactly what their composition is. So it's almost like having a diamond on metal or a ceramic that's stronger than your steel. They are incredible. They're really wide, they run true, and they make a beautiful edge. I think this is probably 80, and I think this is 120, I'm gonna guess. I got these from Ron Brown's Best, and they work tremendously well. There's no balancing, no nothing. They go on just bam, and they're good. And I'm still using Don Geiger's system right here, and this is the Pro Sharp. And I gotta tell you, it is saving me a lot of tool steel, because the repeatability of setting it up to do your spindle gouges and your bowl gouges and everything is incredible. And that kind of brings me to one point, because I had a problem over the years. People would always say, what angles are you using? And I go, well, I'm using 40 to 45 degrees on my spindle gouge and things like that. And one time I was getting ready to go do a demonstration, so I thought I'd just measure them. Well, I couldn't find a good gauge to measure them. I finally hacked one together, and the angle was like 27 degrees on my spindle gouge. It's like, oh my gosh, what happened? Well, what happened is bevel creep, because these things are all movable no matter what you do. And no matter how perfect you are putting stuff up, even if you're just at half a degree off, you're slowly going to change the angle on your bevel. In other words, this angle is going to start either going in or out like that. Now, it's not a bad thing, but you want to be consistent. So I looked all over trying to find an angle gauge where I could at least verify that the $900 or $1,000 I spent on my sharpening system, I'm getting the angle I needed. Couldn't find it. So that's when I decided, okay, well, I'm going to make my own. And that's where I came up with the Woodturner's angle gauge. And this has 35, 40, 45, 55, 60, 75, 15, and then 25, 35, and 45. This is spindle and roughing, spindle and roughing, spindle and roughing. This is bowl gouge, and this is for scraper and negative rake. And then right here, these are for skews and for parting tools. And the way it works is I got really tired of having to take my tool and stick it into a piece of metal. So what I do with this is you lay it on top and you just bring it up, and you see the edge, there's no light showing through that edge. I know I'm at a perfect 45. So now I can guarantee that everything I do on my grinder is going to match with where I want to be. And the reason I put so many angles on there is because it's different strokes for different folks. You might not want to have yours at a 55. See, that's not a 55. You might want yours at a 60. It's all up to choice. You can also come up here with a bowl gouge and make it into a 75, and you can see the gap there. Until you get rid of that gap, then you have a 75. But that's how I do my scraper. I have 75 here, and then the relief grind up here, which is so tricky for everybody, I have that right there, so you can see it's 15 degrees. And the neat thing is then you can take your parting tools and stick them up in there, and your skew chisels and stick them up in there, and they don't dull the tool points. But anyway, that's the gauge I came up with, and it is available on our website, woodturningwithtim.com, if you want to buy one. Also, they're going to be available in a lot of stores pretty soon, but for right now, you can find them only on our website. But to me, if you have a dull tool, you have a dangerous tool. You have to have a sharp tool to turn well, but you also have to have a tool that you can repeat the grind on consistently, so when you approach the work, nothing's changing and it's always the same. I think my head's swelling. This is getting tighter the more I use it. Okay, we've gotten this pretty much rounded out. Now we gotta start making the shape, and it's just simply a cone, right? Okay, so this is gonna be the bottom of the lighthouse, this is gonna be the top, so this has to be narrower. Well, the trick I use is I take my tool rest, and right now it's lined up with the bed of the lathe, so it's perfectly parallel. I wanna take it now and turn it in and get the idea of what angle I want on here. So now that that's set up like so, I'm simply just gonna follow the tool rest as a guide. Now also, watch now, see the shake? I can go past the shake now and pick the speed up on the lathe and get a better cut and quicker cut. So I just am gonna follow the tool rest angle, and that's how I'm gonna put this nice slope on the lighthouse. Once I get that done, we're gonna put a tenon on the end so we can put this in a chuck. Oh, a sharp tool works so much better. Now I have my shape the way I want it, and one quick way to check it is to take a straight edge and put it on there. And if there's not a lot of light showing there, you know you're pretty straight. A couple spots that I can sand out, but the naked eye won't see that once it's done. So that looks really good. So the next step we're gonna do is I'm gonna just simply put a tenon on here, and I've already taken a bowl gouge and cleaned up the end because it's really rotted dead wood, so I wanted to get into more solid wood. And so now I have my parting tool, and we're just gonna make a shelf here. So we'll come in. This is such a big piece, you gotta really watch the angle that you approach this at. And I just sharpened my parting tool too because I wanted to get the easiest cut possible here. And you see I'm riding the bevel, coming down. Now I've already put the diameter on here that my chuck saws require. So I'm gonna come back, make one more pass. And then you're all pretty familiar with my bevel making tool, or my tenon making tool. Well, I've kind of modified it. Let me show you what's going on here with this thing. Before, it was straight and went out to the top, and it had a straight edge here. And all I could do were right-handed tenons. Well, now I've doubled it up, so I can do left-sided tenons. It's a work in progress, so don't quote me on it yet, but I'm liking the way it's working out. It seems to be going okay, but I'm gonna futz with it some more over the next few months or a few weeks and see how this all works out. But I can still make my tenon just like I used to, but I can take it in straight now. And this makes a clean cut. It's almost like taking in a skew, but this is a much thicker piece of metal, so there's gonna be less vibration, less trouble with it. Come in here and just undercut that edge just a bit. Okay. You just cut on both sides like that, so hope this works out. There you go. Well, one thing I wanted to do before I turn this around is go ahead and sand it now because it is already centered. If I turned around on the chuck, it's gonna be a little bit off center, so it'll make it a little tougher to sand. So right now it's perfectly centered, so when I sand now, it's gonna be easier job. And I'm only gonna go to 240 grit. I don't need a real fine surface on this. I want it to look a little bit rustic. So make sure you wear your breathing protection. You have your HEPA filter running in the background and protect those lungs. Well, I reverse this on here turned my puck on. And everything's running pretty smoothly. With this hanging out this far, I wouldn't want to do any turning on this whatsoever. Ah, did I mention that they bounce well? Anyway, the deal is I need to drill a hole that this puck is going to drop into because I don't want this bulb to be above this edge because then that would show through the light. I just want the light coming up. So I've got a 2.5 inch Forstner bit here, and I'm going to go ahead and drill a hole in here. It's going to take a little bit because this is really, really tough wood. And it's gonna make a little smoke, pick the speed up here, but I won't go too fast. But anyway, I'll drill this in, I'll get it deep enough that I can drop that light in there, and then we'll start working on the Paduk part of the lighthouse. It really helps to have a sharp one of these too. I don't know. Now we're ready to turn the Paduk for the top and the bottom of the lighthouse. So I have an 8-inch, 2-inch thick piece for the bottom, and I have about a 7-inch, about a 1-inch thick piece for the top. And the process is pretty simple because this is all assembly. So right now, that piece of Paduk is sitting just like this, and what I want to do first is I want to turn a recess in here so that it will jam fit over the top of the lighthouse. Now I've hauled this out a little bit with my bowl gouge, and I'm just working it in to get the width just right for a jam fit. So I'm using a skew at this point. Just take the point in straight and flat, and then just roll it, clean up the bottom. I'm not too worried about how the inside of this looks because it's gonna be the inside. Nobody's gonna see it. We'll test this one more time here. Oops, hit my camera. Okay, so we're close. I don't really need a jam fit. I mentioned that earlier. You actually want a loose fit because this is built in pieces and I want it to be able to come apart so you can get into the light and all that sort of stuff. So if it's a little bit loose, that's okay. I love turning Paduk. It is such a beautiful wood. It's got a nice grain. It's really soft and it just cuts like butter. Here we go. That is a jam fit right there. So I'm gonna loosen that up just a little bit, and then we're gonna reverse this on the chuck to work on the other side of it. And I just forgot to mention to you, this is actually mounted on a faceplate with double stick tape. And what's really cool about that is that if you cut your blanks out really nice and carefully, and then take the diameter of your faceplate and draw on here with a compass, you can actually use that line to center it up, so when you put that on there, you don't waste a lot of wood, because this stuff's expensive. But anyway, we'll go ahead and work on this a little bit more, and then we'll drill a hole through the center. Now, before we flip this, I do want to make sure one thing, that I hollow this out to where I leave about a quarter of an inch of thickness here, because I want this to sit that much over the top of the lighthouse. By making this thin here, the light has less wood to go through. In other words, if I left it that thick, I already have a hole that deep, the light would be buried. So this thin, it's a nice cap. It's kind of elegant looking too. So anyway, just very carefully hollow this out to the right depth without going through. And then we're gonna drill our hole real quick. Okay, now I'm gonna drill the hole, but I'm only gonna go halfway in, because if I go all the way through with this, it's gonna blow the grain out on the other side and leave it really ugly. So what I'm doing is just marking my territory basically here. There, now I'm gonna come in with a turning tool and turn that through so it'll be nice and clean. Now, just took the time to turn the base just like I did the top, where I made a recess to match the tenon actually on the bottom of the lighthouse. But also, when I had the top on the lathe, I went ahead and drew a circle around it with the blank spinning, and then used the indexer to make 8 equal marks here. I'm going to take this over to the drill press and drill little holes, because that will hold the little arms that are going to hold up our chain that goes around the top. But what I want to do on this now is just give it a little shape, a little bit of design, and I just want to make 3 step downs. Let me show you over here. Excuse my back. But by giving it the 3 step downs, it starts lifting this up. It gives it some shape and some design. So that's really kind of cool. So it's just going to take taking my pencil and come over here and dividing this into 3 segments. 1, 2, and this is why you use a pencil, because if you're a little bit off, you move the line a little bit. Okay, so I got that. Now I just need to grab my bowl gouge, and I'm gonna come in like so, and start making a step. Gonna stop right there, come in and make it deeper. Roll the tool at the end to make a nice straight mark. There's my first step, come in here. Roll the tool, stop it, and there's my second step. That's all it takes. So I'm gonna go ahead and sand it just like I did the top, and then we're ready to go to assembly. Now I'm making the guardrails right now, and this is, you know me, my Mr. Thrifty. This is just simple copper, right? Well, where'd I get my copper? I had some 12 gauge electrical wire from when I built the shop laying around, so I just stripped out one of the pieces of copper in there. And 12 gauge seems to be just about right for the size I need and the strength I need for making this. But anyway, with the holes drilled in here, see if I can do this without blocking the shot too much. You just kind of twist and force it in. And if you have the right size bit, I think I got one that's a little too small, it'll fit a lot nicer than that. But anyway, then you take this little chain that I found at Hobby Lobby or Michael's, and it's in the jewelry section is where I found it. Anyway, I'm not gonna mess with this because it drives me crazy. Because what you have to do is you actually have to separate one of those little tiny links and hook it together once it's on there. But anyway, this will go up on top like so. I have my light inside. We'll even put this up here just to see what it looks like right there. I don't have the light on. But what I did is I used Watco Danish oil to finish the other one. And when you do, it's gonna put a nice coat on there. It's gonna be a nice satiny look. and then you wind up with the perfect looking lighthouse. I think this is a really cool project. It's a great way to use some wood that you found on your own, not spend a lot of money, and it is a neat thing. It'd be a good conversation piece to have in your house. But anyway, I hope you liked that on how to make a lighthouse. So until the next time on Wood Turning, keep turning.
The American Beauty Tim uses was made by Robust Tools. All our lathes have a 7-year warranty. Our tool rests feature a hardened rod on top. Lots of sizes to fit your lathe. Robust, because the making matters.
Thompson Lathe Tools. Welcome to a new level of professional wood turning tools. Made by a wood turner for wood turners.